this camera, sir?
While waiting for the council's verdict, he paid a visit to his mother's home in the Outer Hebrides, accompanied by his sister, Marianne.
I took his hand and I said, "Welcome home." That's how I felt about it.
A room full of long-lost cousins had been lined up. No one doubts Trump's enthusiasm for Scotland, but in planning terms, it's also a convenient time to recall his mother's nationality.
I think he wanted to do something in memory of his mother. And I think this is it.
Trump has put his oldest son, Don Jr., in charge of his Aberdeenshire development.
Well shot, sir.
Thank you. For nice sporting.
Thank you very much.
Don and his brother, Eric, have also thrown themselves into their Scottish identity.
It's kind of scary. I like wearing a skirt. I'm a little worried, but it's actually very comfortable. I think I'm going to have to get one and wear it to more formal occasions. It's definitely better than the typical tuxedo worn in America.
I think this is going to be a very, very important thing for Scotland.
If we have the clubhouse here, the parking should be here. It shouldn't be over to the side. It should be right behind it.
And hopefully I'll be known in Scotland as having really made a major contribution. I only hope I'm given the chance to do something really terrific for Scotland.
Those were the dunes I stood on last time.
There's no question about Trump's passion for the project.
Every time when he comes back home, and he just said that's the most gorgeous place on earth, it's beautiful.
So the road would come down, you would make a right and then a left in.
He said, I would make the most amazing golf course on the world. So we cross the fingers and I know it will happen.
Not everyone shares Trump's enthusiasm. There's concern about the impact of building on this beautiful coastline and its rare wildlife.
If there's a chance that he can be stopped, we will stop.
It's become a bitterly disputed development.
He's so stubborn in the way that he's doing things, and so bullying in his techniques. He's generally just an odious man.
Trump's mother left Scotland and sailed for New York in the 1930s. There she met and married an ambitious builder, Fred Trump.
My father was a very tough, strong businessman. He was a great negotiator and he taught me a lot.
He came from a family of self-made men and his father was notorious for being extremely penny-wise, every single weekend visiting construction sites with the kids, picking up bent nails. Dad worked 7 days a week.
Young Donald went to military school before joining the family firm. Fred Trump had done well in the outer boroughs and never tried to find work in the center of the city across the river. Where the father was cautious, the son Donald was fearless. Donald's first move was to take the Trump Organization across Brooklyn Bridge to the biggest, toughest, most expensive market in the world, Manhattan.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York.
Trump moved to a Manhattan apartment, determined to drag his father's business into the big league.
You came to Manhattan, you were like this pipsqueak. You said, I'm a developer, give me your money, give me a trust. You had nothing to show for it, right?
I had very little to show for it, other than I did a good job with my father in Brooklyn. And we did really, you know, I did a lot of good jobs out there. And so when I came into Manhattan, I felt confident.
Mm-hmm. However good it looked from a distance, the Manhattan that Trump found in the early 70s was falling apart. Many of its businesses had declared bankruptcy. Among them, the Penn Central Railroad Company. Ned Eichler was hired to raise money for its creditors by selling off its New York property portfolio.
So the phone rang one day, and my secretary said to me, there's a man named Donald Trump on the phone, and I had never heard of him. And this sort of brash voice comes over the phone, and he said, when are you coming to New York so I can talk to you?
Trump had big ideas. He said he wanted to develop one of the huge properties Eichler was disposing of.
We took a walk in Central Park, and he pointed to all the buildings, and he said, I'm 29 years old. I'm going to be bigger than anybody in New York in 5 years.
Trump's first target was a dilapidated hotel next to Grand Central Station. Der Scutt, a young architect, found himself caught up in Trump's ambitions.
The Commodore Hotel was a rundown, really derelict building at one of the prime locations in New York City. It was absolutely the worst building possible. Donald saw an opportunity.
Here was a young man who nobody had heard of, telling people he was a developer. He didn't have a building to his name. And yet, by sheer force of will, he managed to persuade the bankers, lent him millions, and a major hotel chain to sign up to his promises.
Trump gutted the inside of the building and clad the outside in a layer of reflective glass. He borrowed $120 million to transform the old Commodore into a new and defiantly modern Grand Hyatt Hotel. It was the birth of the Trump style.
No limestone, no faded Persian carpets, no walnut paneling, none of that, and no understatement. Absolutely no understatement ever.
So where did this young man find his confidence? Well, strange to say, it may have been in church. The Trumps worshipped here, where the minister was Norman Vincent Peale.
Well, Norman Vincent Peale believed in the power of positive thinking, and he wrote a book called The Power of Positive Thinking. I would listen to him speak even in his 70s, and he was just a fantastic guy. He was a minister, and that was the church I went to.
Peale's message allowed his congregation to feel good about their worldly ambitions.
What is a successful life? To make a lot of money, or to get your name in the paper? Well, conceivably, it could be.
We were brought up with that as very much a tenet of faith. The Gospels say, in the end, all will be well. Out of bad comes good. The power of positive thinking. And I think that's very much in Donald's makeup.
You got to accent to aid the positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative, but don't mess with Mr. In Between.
For Trump, positive thinking means success, and success is everything.
I think success brings great enjoyment, and certainly it has for me. Trump National Golf Club is a tremendous success, and it's also been a very successful course. So I had a lot of success, but now it's a really great success.
I want to find out how Trump runs his businesses. I'm on my way to his golf course in Westchester, just outside New York. This is how he hopes the Aberdeen project will turn out a few years from now.
Emily, this is the ballroom at Trump National Westchester. It holds about 700 people. I was telling you...
Showing me round is Eric Trump.
You know, this is what we're going to do in Scotland. This is really the final product.
might want to check the prices before signing up.
We have 300 members, and their initiation fee is over $300,000 to get in, so it's a steep price ticket, but...
Are there queues for that? Is there a long waiting list, or can you join immediately?
There is a waiting list.
And how much would they pay per year? How does that work?
It differs club to club, but here it's about $20,000 a year. Should we go look to the rest of the clubhouse?
And Eric says they'd be charging those sort of fees in Scotland too.
So Emily, I'll take you up to the men's locker room.
Yeah, well, that's a first for me. It's the kind of club where you don't need to remember your locker number.
Well, Clint Eastwood, Mayor Rudolph Giuliani, Jack Nicholson, President William J. Clinton. That's,
very good friend of ours. Very nice
that's,
man.
That's so. Quite a locker room.
But it's not till you get to the bathroom that you really experience the full-on Trump style.
People want the dark woods. They want the beautiful marbles. This is the finest quality Breccia marble.
Breccia,
really,
where does that come from then?
It comes from Italy. That's what people expect, and that's what they expect from Trump. And ultimately, that's why they pay the membership that they do. They want to be a part of the best, and they want to be able to bring their friends and colleagues here and show them this beauty.
What would this be, gold-plated?
It is gold-plated.
It's very fancy, Eric. Mm-hmm. Would you call it showy?
Certainly. I would hope it's showy. So welcome back, everybody.
As Eric gave a pre-season pep talk to the staff, I'd seen he could walk the walk and talk the talk.
Team ready?
We're ready to go, Mr. Trump.
Yes, sir.
But had he really earned his job?
People don't realize that when we're building a new hotel, a couple days ago, Ivanka and myself and Don were in a room with 40 mattresses choosing the new mattress for the hotel collection. We choose every sheet. We choose every paint color, every mirror, every TV. We negotiate those deals.
So what about if I asked you, to name the grass that you use out on the golf course, or if I ask you about, who commissioned the art, or where the chairs come from, or who made the sofa? Are you that hands-on?
Absolutely. And quite frankly, we've negotiated every single one of those deals. In most cases, we've picked out the various
Go on, tell
furniture.
Me, what's the grass out there, then?
That's Pas Palam out there.
And what about that chandelier?
Schoenbeck makes these chandeliers.
Sounds like it's German.
Austrian, actually.
Austrian.
So.
Long before Eric was born, his father ran the Trump Organization like a family business. First to be drawn in was a Czech-born former ski champion and model, Ivana Winkelmeier, who was almost as ambitious as he was.
He wooed her very ardently. She, as who wouldn't, was quite taken with whipping around New York City in a limo and with the prospect of being part of this growing dynasty.
Donald and Ivana got married, and Ivana quickly became part of Trump's business life with a desk in the office and a top management job. She was by his side for his next project, the one that made his name.
Well, Trump Tower was one of my earlier battles, and at the time it was very, very controversial because it's a very tall building. It's 68 stories, and it's right next to Tiffany, which is a very iconic building that's been there a long time.
Trump wanted his new building to be massive. He knew that each building in the city had so-called air rights, permission build up to a maximum height. He also knew that air rights were a tradable commodity.
When Donald Trump saw that the neighboring building, Tiffany, was pretty small, a few stories high, meaning it hadn't bothered to claim its air rights, he bought them. That meant his building could be even taller.
It was incredibly difficult because the building kept growing taller and taller and taller, and he realized that the value he paid for the air rights was a small token and maybe quadrupling the price he would get for the real estate up in the sky.
In 1982, the apartments went on sale, starting at $500,000. They were such a success that they paid for the whole building, even before Trump sold the retail space at the bottom.